200 to 500 different sign languages around the world, each representing a unique culture and community. Most deaf consider the spoken language that surrounds them as their second language if they learn to read, making written communication minimally effective, especially in third world countries. Many deaf claim to follow whatever religion their parents followed, but upon further investigation, few deaf actually understand what is going on during any type of uninterpreted worship ritual. Most missionaries working with hearing people have neither the ability nor the resources to effectively reach this unique community in their area. Due to these factors and many others, the deaf are the fourth largest unreached people group in the world. Such is the case in Honduras, Central America. Honduras is a Spanish-speaking country, and according to the World Factbook, is 97% Catholic. In this country alone, approximately 18,000 to 70,000 people live in silence, with very few Christian ministries that are equipped to reach them. Hello, I am Maria-Lea, and God has called me to the field of Honduras. I grew up in a godly Christian home, was saved and baptized at a young age, and felt called to missions shortly thereafter. In 2008, I graduated with a three-year Bible degree from Faith Bible Institute, and in 2012, received a Bachelor's of Science degree in nursing. Throughout my education, missions remained my end goal. During college, I fine-tuned other skills, skills that have since served me well in ministry. During a short but intense study abroad trip to Mexico, I realized I couldn't verbally witness to my host family due to the language barrier. I returned to the States looking for immersion opportunities, and in 2011, I had learned enough Spanish to lead a Spanish-speaking woman to Christ. I later became a certified interpreter at my hospital. I thought I was ready for missions, but God had other plans. 4 years ago, I started attending my church's sign language classes, purely out of curiosity. I soon learned enough to start interpreting parts of services and join deaf events. Using my acting background, I co-directed two deaf dramas and several people were saved. Later, I started a Sunday school for deaf children and a weekly Bible study for deaf women. God combined my Spanish and sign language paths while vacationing in Panama in 2013. There, in a Spanish-speaking country, I happened to meet a missionary family who were reaching the deaf. That greatly impacted me. And over the next few months, God clearly called me to go as a missionary to the deaf in Latin America. As a registered nurse, I joined a medical missions team in Honduras. And there, I was introduced to a church planting team with no current means of reaching the deaf.
Team Honduras is an independent Baptist church planting team that was started in 2005. We are currently working in two church plants, both of which are involved in local evangelism and missions giving. We also have a children's home, discipleship program, and Bible Institute to prepare future laborers for the cause of Christ. We are excited about Marie joining Team Honduras because it opens the possibilities of evangelizing the unreached deaf community with the gospel and ministering through medicine for the glory of Jesus Christ.
Though the vast majority of my time will be involved in reaching the local deaf community, I look forward to using the abilities God has given me to help Team Honduras reach their world for the Savior. Throughout my life, God has consistently brought challenges and opportunities that have motivated me to become better prepared to reach those who have never heard the gospel. With His help, I have overcome obstacles and become skilled in a variety of settings, which has, in turn, helped spread the gospel to many. I am ready, prepared, and determined to break the silence for deaf Hondurans, despite the challenges that await. Would you consider supporting me, prayerfully and financially, as I reach Hondurans for Christ?
ask about my hyphenated last name, and it's a lot of people ask about the divorce, especially in the secular world. And you know, and I understand in our day and age that's pretty common, but I usually find it funny because most of the same people ask just an hour ago or last week if I was 15. So that's how that works. I'm not divorced, and I'm also not 15. I am 26, and my great grandfather, they decided to combine their last name Lee with his wife's last name Wilson, and it's a common thing in Britain, he's British, and he decided to just pass that on. So my grandfather was born a Lee Wilson, my father was born a Lee Wilson, I was born a Lee Wilson along with my five brothers, and I like to say I may have been born with two last names. Lord willing, if and when I get married, I'll finally have one. So, switch that. A lot of questions, three top questions that people have is one about my age, but also about nursing. Am I going to be a nurse? Am I going to use my nursing skills on the mission field? And I didn't describe it a lot on the video, but I absolutely will be. It's neat, when I knew God wanted me to work with the deaf in a Spanish-speaking country, that's still a big, huge area. As you know, there's a lot of Spanish-speaking countries. So I started looking, and I started traveling, and I started doing some survey trips and working with a couple of different missionaries and just praying, God, do you want me here? God, do you want me there? God, do you want me to work with these people or that country? And I had done several, and I learned about Team Honduras. And as we started emailing back and forth and communicating, I learned that he said, Matt Goins, the guy who was on there, he said, by the way, we're planning on building a surgical clinic on the church property, and we're looking for a bilingual medical professional who can help coordinate surgical teams down here 2 or 3 times a year. So it was just neat to see how God worked that all out, not only the Spanish and sign language, but also the nursing. And God doesn't waste our time. And I knew God had me learn nursing for a reason, just had, I had to wait and see why. So that's a neat blessing. And of course, you know, you have teen camp, you need a camp nurse. And you have, you know, BBS, you have a BBS nurse. And then they have 2 children's homes, so you always need a nurse. So I will be well used. And I look forward to that. Another question a lot of people ask is about sign language. And I asked, or some of the kids asked this question this morning at junior church. Is sign language the same around the world, or is it different? The answer is sign language is absolutely not the same around the world. Sign language is different not only in every country, but every often within the same country, there's different variations of sign language. I briefly mentioned on the video there's around 200 to 500 different sign languages around the world. So if you consider there's around 200 different countries, that puts us at around 1 to 3 sign languages per country. The United States has at least 3 top ones. ASL is what we mostly think of. And then we have SEE, Sign Exact English, and we have MCE, Manually Coded English, and lots of other smaller, less developed sign languages here alone in the United States. In Honduras, it's an interesting situation because Honduran Sign Language, which the acronym is LESHO, L-E-S-H-O, LESHO, and it stands for, of course, it's in Spanish, which means Honduran Sign Language. They established it in the late 1980s, so obviously that's incredibly recent for any language. And the problem in Honduras, as is a problem in many developing countries, is that when you have deaf people who are already in a poor country, and already it's hard to find a job anyway, and not here they're deaf and they can't find a job, they typically don't tend to travel a whole lot. So you'll have this deaf person or this deaf couple in this city for their entire lives, and this deaf person and these deaf kids in this city for their entire lives, and they never meet each other. Well, you can imagine how their sign languages and their little slang and whatever can morph very quickly within a couple of years, even if it started out the same. So we have that in Honduras where everybody says they speak Lesho, or all the deaf people say, oh yeah, I sign Lesho. But you go to this person, you go to that person, they're signing 2 very different things. So that's been an interesting challenge. One missionary that's worked with the deaf, I talked to her, and she says, we've found 16 different signs for the name Moses. So I don't know how you can come up with 16 different signs for the name Moses. But so there's a work going on trying to standardize Honduran Sign Language. And it's quite an undertaking, but it is happening currently. And what's interesting about sign language is that facial expressions are almost universal. So signs may not be, but facial expressions are. And a neat testimony is that when I was a teenager, you may have seen briefly up there that I was a clown. And I was trained as a professional clown. I was a professional clown for about 4 years, trained prior to that, of course. And here as a clown, our instructor said, I need you to go practice your facial expressions. And I don't know, smile, but he would make us go home and so if you brush your teeth and you finish, is that bathroom word? All these things, you just go really silly. But I started learning as a mime, with my voice off always, a clown, how to get a reaction from my audience without using my words. And it just worked, just now. It was neat to use that. But then here I started learning sign language, and I learned that over half of sign language, any sign language, is in your face. There are signs that if you have a smile on can mean one thing, and if you have a not so nice face on can mean a curse word. So it's very drastically different depending on what your face is saying. So that was a neat thing, how when I started learning sign language and I would walk up to a deaf person, I'd be all awkward, I don't know what I was saying, and I'd try to sign a sentence, and they'd just look at me. And they would laugh. And they would say, all your signs are wrong. But I understand what you're saying, because your expressions are perfect. I was like, cool, I'll take it. So just neat how God has been preparing me in just the small ways that you would never think of being a clown would help you be a missionary, but it does. And so not too many people are surprised when I say clown. But anyway, so I'm excited to be able to use that, be able to use sign language, be able to use nursing, be able to use the other skills that God has given me. In Honduras, I was homeschooled all 12 years, and I'm just so grateful to my parents for spending that time in training us and raising us in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And it was truly them that got us started. My mom always said, a busy teen is a happy teen. So we learned a lot in our young teen years and later teen years. And I'd like to say, thank you, Lord, so much for everything you've given me. Of course, to whom much is given, much shall be required. So I look forward to using that on the mission field. The song I'm about to sing is called I Am Deaf, Do You Care? And it was written by the wife of a missionary, or a deaf man, deaf pastor in the United States. So she was very much involved in the deaf world, is very much involved in the deaf world. And she wrote the song from several different perspectives. And so just listen and kind of imagine different perspectives. Also, I translated one of the choruses into Spanish, just as a reminder that deaf people are not just the United States, but all over the world. So again, it's called I Am Deaf, Do You Care? I'm gonna slide over here. Yes, it's like
I saw a little boy shuffling sadly down the street. His parents sent him out to beg for food. People just passed by him, then he gave up in defeat. He started
send out updates, blogs, and prayer letters. So you can put your email or your home address on that, and I will send you those as well. So thank you so much. God bless. Appreciate it.
Appreciate that. And I hope that's a challenge to you. And thankful for, first off, I'm thankful for her parents. Boy, they really had her involved. And you can see how much all that she asserted herself in growing up and how the Lord's using that now. And boy, that's a challenge our young people are going to hear. She's going out to the youth work right now. So pray for her out there. But that's a blessing and certainly a challenge to us. We care. We care about those who haven't ever heard. And in this case, many who cannot, and how will they be reached? So praise the Lord for that. Turn your Bibles tonight, if you would, to the book of Acts, Acts chapter 5, and somewhat transitioning in. We have studied through this book, but here tonight we're going to look at that first mission, so to speak, that early church where they were reaching people who could hear and yet had never understood the gospel. People who were coming to Christ, ones who were proclaiming. And of course, what we find and what we always realize and have to see is whenever you're trying to do what's right, whenever you're trying to serve the Lord, there's going to be opposition. We have to be ready for that. I've seen that over and over again in people's lives. Talked with someone here recently, and they're explaining what was going on and got behind the scenes to see what they were striving to do in their family and striving to do in their lives, and even how the Lord had been blessing and prospering. And I said, don't you realize what's happening is you're under assault. You are under attack. And it's just the way that the adversary is trying to discourage you and to keep you from keeping on and keeping on and doing what he's called you to do. And that discouragement can come from so many different places. But aren't you glad that no matter what our adversary is going to attempt to do, in the end, God wins. The church will triumph. I'm so thankful for that promise. We can hang on to that. And if we could just wrap our minds around it, just that phrase that Jesus spoke, he says, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. But just so much power packed into that statement. I will build my church. This isn't our church. This is God's church. And, the fact that it's his gives so much more value to it. But also the fact that it's his gives so much greater responsibility to us, because it's not for us that we labor, it's not for us that we serve, but for his glory. And then beyond that, to know it's his church, and so he's the one that Satan's picking on and Satan messes with us. Aren't you glad for that? And he's the one who is sovereign, he's the one who's in control, and he's the one that's going to see that the church continues. In Acts chapter 5, we're going to look, if you would, tonight in verse number 17 and 18. We're going to look tonight how the church and that early church triumphed. The church triumphant in Acts chapter 5. And notice here, if you would, beginning just over verse number 17, we're just going to read a short portion. We're going to try to finish out this chapter tonight. But it says, then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees. Remember, there was the Sadducees and the Pharisees, which were constantly withstanding the work that Jesus did. The Sadducees were more of the religious liberals of their day, though the Pharisees didn't have the truth either. They were wrapped up in their traditions. The Sadducees denied everything supernatural. They would follow the Mosaic law. They were tied in with the temple. They were very wealthy. Didn't want anything to do with the supernatural. They denied a resurrection. They denied the existence of angels and on down the line. But the Sadducees were filled, the Bible tells verse 17, with indignation, that anger, overcome with animosity. They laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. But the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors, brought them forth, and said, go, stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. I even love the way that that's put. Go speak all the words of this life. There's a lot for us to see here tonight in this passage and really the rest of the chapter. As we look at the church triumphing, I want us to first of all consider the circumstances that we find in Acts chapter 5. We saw to begin with, a couple weeks ago, the story of Ananias and Sapphira. We learned from that story the necessity of a pure church. We saw how in verses 1 through 11, Satan has tried to bring pressure from without. And Satan now, in chapter 5, is trying to destroy the church from within. There is a plant, so to speak. Some that are now in this group of people, these ones who, unlike any church before or after, in fact, there could have been a church before, they were the first church, but any other church since, they were united. They had a common goal, they had a common mission, a common purpose. They are on fire for Christ. They're giving their lives a living sacrifice, and loving God, and loving His people, and loving others. But there Satan had brought some into their midst, Ananias and Sapphira, some who proclaimed Christ, and we know how that they claimed to have sold some land, and then they were going to bring the money from that sell of the land and lay it at the apostles' feet. Of course, they were keeping some of it back. They were coming to try to get notoriety for themselves. They were, while everyone else was living for God, they were living for self. They were trying to be trying to fulfill their own will, their own purpose, living for their own kingdom. We saw how the Lord dealt with that. The Bible tells us both Ananias and Sapphira dropped dead in the church as God was standing for His church. He was not going to let Satan win the day. We find it in this passage. After that, we saw how through that purifying, how the Lord keeping them pure, the power of God stayed on them, and the power of God was shown through the apostles so that many more believed. The Bible tells verse number 14, believers were more added to the Lord, multitudes both of men and women. But we see the circumstances. Because it's a church that's prospering, it's a church that's under persecution. It's a church that's being persecuted by the adversary. It was a constant target of Satan. He doesn't stop now that Ananias and Sapphira are gone. Now he's going to go back to that initial plan and only just ratchet up the persecution. We find for the first time in Acts chapter 5, God's people being arrested and thrown into prison. Arrested and thrown into prison. We read the words in verse number 18, the Sadducees came and they came with their soldiers and they put their hands on them and they threw them into common prison. This is the first experience that these men have had with prison, and by the way, it won't be the last. Many of these men would visit many a prison, laugh about the Apostle Paul when he'd go into town. I wonder if he didn't go and check out the local prison first of all just to see where he'd be staying. But it got around to it, he got thrown in time and time and time again. Satan was relentless. Satan was subtle. Satan, however, is defeated. The gates of hell will not prevail against the church. Jesus already made His declaration. And so we look at the circumstances, what's going on. This church is under persecution. This church is under attack. But we're going to notice in this passage the confirmation of the church as well. Look back, if you would, at verses 12 to 16. These people had no doubt that regardless of what was going on around them, regardless how others responded, regardless of how they were treated, they knew the Lord was with them. They had a confirmation to the presence of God in their lives. Notice, it says in verse 12, by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders wrought among the people. We find in verse number 15, insomuch they brought forth the sick into the streets, laid them on beds and couches, that at the least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. There came also a multitude out of the cities round about in Jerusalem, bringing sick folks and them which were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed every one. They had this miraculous gift of healing that was there with the apostles that the Lord had given them by the Holy Spirit. Now understand, that was a temporary gift. There are some today who claim to have the gift of healing. They are speaking lies. No one today has the gift of healing. The Lord still heals. And He heals through answers to prayer, the prayers of God's people. But no one has the gift of healing. If someone had the gift of healing, they would walk right down to Sarasota Memorial Hospital and clear the place out. Let them prove that gift. The gifts that people claim today are nothing like what they had in the Bible. Here these people came and they were healed, every one. You see, they didn't say, well, these folks over here, we didn't heal because they didn't have enough faith. No, they healed every one. It was a sign. And what the Lord was doing was He was demonstrating for everyone to see that these were God's people and that His hand was on them and they were preaching His message. Now from time to time, people will ask, why doesn't God do that anymore? Wouldn't it be something if one of us had the gift of healing? Wouldn't it be amazing if we could walk down today and go and clear out, you know, Bayfront Hospital down in Fort Charlotte, just walk into a few rooms and say, rise up and walk. Like that lame man that Peter and John saw at the temple. He'd been lame 40 years, and they just come and they grab him by the hand, and he gets up and he starts leaping around, and everybody, the whole city those signings. Wouldn't that be great?
You know what? The reality is we have something greater. We have a greater miracle. We have the miracle of the Word of God.
In that early church, something that they did not have was the New Testament. They didn't have the Word of God completed. They didn't have that which was perfect. It was not come yet. And how was God going to verify that these men were His if they were speaking the truth? He did it by the sign gifts.
Right.
But today, He verifies His people and the message they preach by the Word of God. Now this book is a miraculous book. Never lose sight of that. I know in America we've had it so much, we've had it so prevalently that we lose sight of just how powerful, miraculous it is. Are you acquainted with the prophecies of the Bible? Do you know what God has already fulfilled? Do you know what has already come to pass? Are you familiar with what the Bible has done to transform societies, to change lives? You know, even still today, they won't let the Bible come in the schools in our country anymore. They'll let the Bibles go to prisons. Why? Because they know the Bible makes a difference. The Bible will change people because it's through the Word of God. The Bible tells us in 1 Peter that a person is born again, being born again not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible. The Word of God is the sign today. And remember the words of Jesus. Though one rose from the grave, though one rose from the dead, and came back and preached the truth, still men would not hear and repent if they won't hear the Word of God. Those are the words that Jesus Christ Himself spoke. We have a sign. We have today a test. We have today a miraculous gift from God. And it's something for us to recognize and something for us to rejoice in. The church is still confirmed, and God's promises are still true. And we sang a little while ago, standing on the promises, these things are still for us today. Notice the third thing in this passage. We see the circumstances. We see the confirmation. They knew the Lord was with them. But notice also here the continuation of the church. We see a continuation, first of all, by divine providence. They continued because God said they were going to continue. When the Lord is in charge, when the Lord has a plan, when the Lord has made His promise, there's nothing that can stop what He's going to do. Here we find these apostles, the leaders, and as the book of Ephesians says, the foundation of the early church, cast into prison. By the way, notice how false religion does not care for its own followers. What had they done to get thrown into prison? You know what they had done to get thrown into prison? They're healing people. They're making people well. They're clearing out the hospital. And here come these other religious leaders, and they're grieved by it. And they're angered by it. And so they grab hold of them, they chain them up, and they throw them into prison. Understand, false religion does not care about anybody. False religion does not care for their souls. Look at James says that a pure religion, undefiled before God the Father, is this, one that visits the fatherless and the widows in their affliction. If you don't have a care for people, then your religion is vain.
Right.
These folks, they didn't care. They're grieved. Well, people are getting healed and getting changed. Why were they grieved? Because they looked at the possibility and the potential of them losing their influence. Well, what's that going to do to me? That's all that they care about. So much so today still in false religion. Consider how in this passage we notice here, these who fought against God, they willingly turned away from His miraculous revelation. Imagine these men, these Sanhedrin. They've got all this going on before them. They've got people being healed. They've heard the testimony. Jesus Christ is risen from the grave. Don't forget that that is something that has just recently happened. This is an early church. Miracles are transpiring all about them. But they are turning a willful, blind ear to all of that. They said, I'm still going to throw them in prison. Yeah, I heard that Jesus rose again. Yeah, the tomb is empty. Yeah, they're healing people. And still they throw them into prison. Hard as could be. That's a hard heart. There's some people today where you can talk to them and you're just like, what is wrong with you? God has shown you so much time and time and time again. I was talking to another man recently and this always just, it just doesn't make sense. He looked at me directly and he said, if I died today, I would be in hell. He said, but I know you're going to tell me I need to get saved and I know I need to get saved, but I just got some other things right now. With this? What don't you get? You could be in everlasting fire and you know this and still you won't repent and trust Christ. There's such a hardness in me.
Remember, the Word of God, God tells us that the God of this world, Satan, he's blinded their hearts. Just so that they will not hear. And that's what's going on in this passage. They fought against John the Baptist. These men had fought against Jesus and crucified him. Now they're crying for battle with the apostles. It's all tragic because the Sadducees, you know what, they're not around anymore. The Pharisees we still have. We still have those Jewish rabbis who continue in the Pharisaical traditions. The Sadducees are gone. 70 AD, the destruction of the temple, and they ceased to be. They could have repented, they could have come to the truth, but they were harmed. But we notice in this passage, in spite of what they do and throwing him into prison, that the Lord merely used the prison as overnight accommodations for the apostles. He simply walks in with the angel of the Lord, verse number 19, and by night he opens the prison doors, he brings them forth, and he gives them that commission again, go and speak the truth. Here it is. See, I mean, I don't know how many different guards there were. I'm sure that there was someone right outside the door. We've got 11 men, 12 men that are in this prison cell. No doubt there are some that are down the hall. No doubt there are some at the main gate. And all these things are locked and shut and closed. And the angel of the Lord just comes. He just flings those doors open. He just casts the chains off. He just draws them straight out while the rest of the prison keepers, they just sleep through the whole thing. He opens every door and they're gone. And apparently he closed it all right behind them. Because the Bible tells us in the morning, they go and they look in the prison cell and, where are they? They just disappeared. The Lord can do anything. This Thursday, I'll be preaching to the teenagers. I'm looking forward to it. I'm preaching to them on the flood. And one of the things about the flood, you know, so many times they'll say, well, how could God have gotten all those animals to Noah? And how could this have happened? And how could that have happened? You know what? God can do anything He wants to do. God simply said, let there be light, and boom, there was light. That's all it took. That's how our God is, and that's how powerful He is. God can do anything. Do you believe that? I love this picture, just a picture here of salvation. The moment that one believes, every wall, every chain, every satanic outpost is defeated. God doesn't. They don't have to come and God simply opened one door. Now they've got to find a way out of the other. But the moment somebody believes on Jesus Christ, the Lord sets them free. All the chains are gone. Every prison door is open. I also love the picture here where Satan, you know, he's got the apostles. He's just worked up. You know, he thought he had won when Jesus was crucified. Then Jesus rose again. And now he knows that he's defeated. But now he's going to try to stop the church. He gets all these men bottled up in a prison. He's finally happy. All right, let's see what God's going to do now. And God just simply says, come on out, guys. Recently, I was walking through my kitchen. And little Asa, you know, he's 3 years old. And he sticks his hands out on the wall on this side and his hands on that side. He looks at me and he says, Dad, you can't get through. And I looked at that, I wasn't real intimidated. I just said, excuse me there, buddy. Just walked right on by. That's about how effective Satan is against the Lord. He can't stop. If it's the Lord's plan, if it's the Lord's will, it's going to happen, it's going to be done. Praise God, we're on that side. We're on the winning side. We're on God's side. Really, in this passage, we see the continuation of the church was due to the providence of God, but also it was due to personal perseverance. While God in His providence was going to see to it these men would walk out, you'll notice also their personal responsibility that these men were given a command. Here they are, they're in prison. They just got released in verse number 20, and the Lord tells them to do what? Go back and do what you just got in trouble for doing. Go right back to that temple again and start preaching the truth again. You know, I might think to myself, well, aren't we just going to end up right back where we were? But okay, you know, if that's where we want me to go, that's what they decided to do. Just go back again. Just keep going. Just keep preaching. Just keep doing what I called you to do. You know, the Lord calls us to perseverance.
Right.
Look in the book of 1 Kings where we were this morning, 1 Kings chapter 18. You see how Elijah with his servant, as they were praying for rain, that he told his servant over and over again, he said, go back again. Go back again. Elijah was praying and the servant went up and he said, I don't see anything, there's not any clouds, there's no sign of rain. Elijah says, go back again. Elijah kept praying. 7 times! He just kept saying, go back! Go back! Go back! God's given us a promise. Keep looking. It's going to come to pass. You just keep persevering. That's what the Lord tells us to do in His work. That's what the Lord tells us to do in prayer. You keep going. Remember, be not weary in well-doing. In due season we shall reap if we faint not. He says, go back. Don't give up. Keep pressing on. Keep speaking the truth. Keep giving out the tracts. Keep on in your prayer life. Keep on doing what's right at home. Keep on at the workplace. Be a light. God will bless it. Keep on. That personal perseverance is so needed. We also notice here the continuation of the church, not just by that personal perseverance, not only by the providence of God, but also by the preaching of the gospel. Look again, verse number 20. Mentioned it already, but he tells them, go, stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. You notice what he told them to share? He didn't tell them to go and share a religion, did he? He didn't tell them to go and talk to them about some rituals that they needed to do. He didn't go and tell them to quote some sort of vain repetitions. He said, go and share with them the words of this life. A new life. A whole new existence. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Jesus said, marvel not that I say unto you, you must be born again. Life. This is what he offers. Jesus said, I have come that they might have life, and they might have it more abundantly. The Christian life is not just a list of do's and don'ts. It's life. It's finally coming to life. Real life. The life that we were created to enjoy. A life where we are in relationship to God. Where He speaks to us and to our hearts. We have that communion with Him. That life now where we bring forth the joy and the peace, the love, the long-suffering, all the fruits of the Spirit. He wants us to have life. A life that is fruitful. A life that is blessed. You'll notice here he says, go and speak to the people all the words of this life. It's not that there's many different ways. There's only one way to life. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And these men need to go and preach it again because he is the only way.
Right.
They had to go and they risk their lives because there is only one way. And it's that urgent. It's that vital. And so the apostles kept preaching. You notice in this passage, he tells them, you can just go on. This life that he gives, it's a resurrected life, an abundant life. Look at verse 22, if you would. The Bible tells us that conclusion, we're just going to jump ahead to the end as we think about their preaching for a moment. Notice how they preached daily. Daily they preached. Every day. They couldn't get tired. They couldn't stop. They just kept on sharing that gospel message. They kept on speaking those words of life. It says daily in the temple. They didn't pull back from those risky areas. They went right to where the Sadducees were. Every day, back at the temple. It says that in every house, anyone that would hear them, they were ready to share with them the words of life. By the way, I can think of no higher privilege in this life to simply show a sinner how to be saved.
Amen.
I can think of no higher blessing than to simply take the word of God and tell somebody, Jesus has died for Jesus wants to save your soul. He says, come, you will know what's cast you out. That's his invitation. What a privilege it is to bring that. Why do we ever stop? Why do we ever give in? These men kept on preaching daily in the temple, in every house. They ceased not to teach. They ceased not to preach. Simply this message. Jesus. They preach Christ. Jesus, the Savior. He is Christ. He's the Messiah. And they preach Jesus Christ risen. They preach Jesus Christ that He had died for their sins. They preach that Jesus Christ was the answer, the way. They preached Him. They wouldn't stop. You know, our lives ought to preach Christ. Our lips ought to preach Christ. We have to get back to the point where we realize this is how the church continues. It's not in buildings, it's not in offerings, although those things are important. It's in the gospel message. It's in preaching Christ. What part will you play in preaching Christ to the lost world? What part are you playing? In Sunday school, we talked about how we have the jobs that we have, not by coincidence, but by God's appointment. You have the neighbors that you have, not by coincidence, but by God's divine appointment. You have the family that you have, not by coincidence, but by God's divine appointment. Will you share with them the words of this life? Has Jesus changed you? I hope He has. But why wouldn't you want to share with others what He has done for you? That's the instruction that he gave, the simple instruction to that poor maniac, that madman of Gadara. Just go home and tell your friends what great things that God has called you to do. Notice in this passage in Acts chapter 5, we see the continuation of the church by gospel preaching. We see the continuation of the church because of the providence of God. But now notice also the charge to the church. Look at the charge to the church. Verse number 29. What happens in this passage? Just kind of jump to verse 29 in a minute. What happens in the passage? They go back in the temple and they're preaching again. And it cracks me up. Really makes me kind of laugh and smile that the adversaries here, the Sadducees, what do? They go and they arrest them again. It reminds me of the time where Jesus had raised Lazarus. And so all the Sadducees and the Pharisees got together and they said, what are we going to do? We better kill Lazarus and Jesus. Well, he just rose from the dead. What's the sense of killing him again? If Jesus can just bring him back to life, they're not even thinking right. But here they just got out of prison. They just walked out that they'd been locked up. They said, well, what are we going to do? Let's throw them in prison again. You know, the world is full of just dumb ideas. You know that? You hear plenty of them in the political season, that's for sure, right? Just bad, bad ideas. Self-defeating things. That's what they do. They throw them back in prison. Bring them before him again. They said, look, didn't we tell you not to preach in the name of Jesus? Look at verse number 28. Behold, ye have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine, with his teaching, and you intend to bring this man's blood upon us. Hallelujah! I hope to bring the blood of Jesus on every man I ever talk to. Of course, they're looking at that and they're saying, this is what's condemning us. You're trying to make us responsible for the death of Jesus. Isn't it ironic, just a few months earlier, when Jesus was standing before Caesar, what did they say? His blood be on us and on our children.
That's right.
What a bunch of cowards. What a bunch of shifters. He said, we're not responsible. We're not to blame. We're not the ones that put Jesus to death. That was the Romans. It was these very men. Here they are trying to shift the blame. You can see how the Holy Spirit's been putting his finger right on them. You can see how the Holy Spirit's been saying, you are the one. By the way, when we come to Christ, we all have to have had that time where the Holy Spirit's shown us, I'm the one that he died for. It's my sins that sent him there. Until I accept and believe that fact, I'll never get saved. I've got to own that. I've got to realize also it is his love that put him there. That he saves me by that shed blood, by that life that was given for me, and by his resurrection. Put your faith there. In this passage, they tell these disciples, quit your preaching, quit it. Notice what the disciples said, verse 29. It says, then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. You know, we can obey our government and civil authority up to one point.
That's right.
And that is this point. When they call us to disobey God. As soon as man's laws conflict with God's laws, we ought to obey God rather than man. Yeah. Now, it's sad in all that's going on in our world, what's going on right now in California. They have a state bill. I don't know if it's passed yet or not. Listen to what the state bill is going to do in the public schools in California. First of all, textbooks and instruction materials must positively promote lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender Americans as role models. Children as young as 6 years old must be taught to admire homosexuality, same-sex marriages, bisexuality, and transsexuality. Children will be taught to support the political activism of the so-called lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, intersex, and questioning political groups, as the bill requires particular emphasis on portraying the role of these groups in contemporary society. Teachers will be made to positively portray homosexuality, same-sex marriages, bisexuality, and transsexuality because to be silent can bring the charge of reflecting adversely or promoting a discriminatory bias. School boards will be required to select textbooks and other instructional materials that positively portray LGBT lifestyles because to be silent on these subjects opens them up to charges of reflecting adversely or promoting a discriminatory bias. And finally, parents will not be notified, nor will they be able to exempt their children from this new core curriculum. It's already passed one house, whether it's the Senate or the House in California. You know what God's people have to do is rise up and say, we have to obey God and not men. Hey, you know what? It's sin. It was sin when the Bible was written. It's sin still today. There is one place for a physical relationship, and that's in the bonds of marriage between a man and a woman. That's it. One man, one woman for life. That's God's plan. Anything beyond that is sin. You know what? It's time for God's people to say, I got to obey God, not man. We know that. Those days are coming for us. And right now, you know, we're worried about certain things and certain effects. This is something that's really coming down real quick. I was, my in-laws, the city they used to live in, is going to now require, they're trying to require all businesses citywide to permit men to use whatever bathrooms and changing rooms they want to. City ordinance. Not in some big city, Chillicothe, Ohio. This stuff is coming quick. It's coming a lot quicker than I ever thought it would. When it comes down to it, we ought to obey God rather than men. Right. Not that we have to do it in a mean way, but in a resolute way. I love the way that Peter simply answered, just plain. We ought to obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, who you slew and hanged on a tree. Isn't that funny? I love the way that he does this. They said, you're trying to blame us for what happened to Jesus. And Peter immediately says, I blame you for what happened to Jesus. Of course, we're all responsible. But they were just as responsible as anybody. Verse 31, him hath God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. This one that you crucified, he's the savior, and we are his witnesses of these things. And so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that obey him. It's interesting in that passage how Peter brings that finger back. They knew what Peter was saying was true. He said, we're witnesses, so is the Holy Spirit is testifying. What will you do with the truth? What will you do with Christ? We see here his call to be witnesses. Finally, we notice in this passage, ultimately what happens, the Bible tells verse 33, praise God, Peter preaches and that conviction comes. It says, when they heard that, they were cut to the heart. They responded the wrong way to conviction. You find it all through Scripture, you find it all through life. Conviction comes, and people will either try to silence that voice, or they'll respond to the truth. Here, they grew hardened. What did they try to do? They took counsel to slay. Prison's not enough. We're going to kill them. Let's just get rid of these guys altogether. Let's put them to death. Ultimately, the Lord preserved their lives. So as a result of one man warning them about killing them in verse number 40, they agreed with this testimony. And so they called the apostles and they beat them. Can you imagine witnessing that day? Seeing that? These men? Picture yourself there as a new believer in this church. You've seen Peter and John and James and all these men arrested, dragged off to prison. Then miraculously, they're right back there the next day. You got word. They say, hey, they're back in the temple. What? You run down there, they're preaching. You're like, how did you get back? Well, the angel of the Lord, he just let us out and he told us to come preach again. So that's what we're doing. And so they're down there preaching. And the Sadducees come and take them again. You're watching this whole thing and there they take Peter in front of everybody and they strip him of his clothing. Take out that whip. They start beating the man of God. Imagine what the people must have thought as they witnessed that. You know, I think that right here, people are looking, how do we respond to these things? Well, look at what the disciples did. It tells us in verse number 41, they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing. Can you imagine Peter comes and he's got his clothes back and somebody comes, Peter, I'm so sorry. Hallelujah, brother. Jesus died for me. I'm so glad I can endure something for his name. And I'm ready to go even further. Amen. You know, the Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 5, and Jesus spoke these words. He says, when men revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you, it says, rejoice and be exceeding glad. He says, great is your reward in heaven. These men here, they just rejoiced and praised the Lord. They just found it a thrill that they could suffer for the cause of Christ. And the Bible tells us there is a crown that comes to those who suffer for Him. Praise the Lord that we have that opportunity to live for God no matter the price. We also find in Hebrews 13:15, Bible offers there, and again in the context, you're talking about Jewish people, the book of Hebrews received that letter, people who were no doubt faced with persecution, intense persecution, and there they're exhorted to offer the sacrifice of praise. There's times when it's easy to praise God. Times like with what Peter and John and all the disciples endured that day, it's not humanly reasonable to praise God. So the Spirit simply filled them, filled their lips and their voices, and they raised their voices and just said, praise the Lord. Praise God. My sins are forgiven. I've got a home in heaven. And I have been able to just stand for the cause of Christ. You know, for you and I today, understand, His church is going to triumph. It always has. It always will. And for us, how do we respond to these truths? We know we've got an adversary. He's going to attack us individually. He's going to attack us collectively. He doesn't want us to preach that gospel. Understand that if you make a resolution in your life, you say, I want to go and I want to share the gospel with my neighbor. I want to be a better witness. I want to spend more time in prayer. Know that He wants to withstand. The Lord might permit it. But if He does, persevere. Press on. Preach the gospel. Obey God. Should you suffer for the cause of Christ, whether it's harsh words, whether it's family that shuns you, whether it's co-workers that won't talk to you, whatever the loss, just rejoice and thank the Lord that He counted you worthy to bear His name. Ultimately, the Lord will turn those things. Even the apostles and their suffering, the Lord was going to use the persecution they endured to scatter and to spread the gospel so that we have it today. That persecution would simply fan the flames of the revival that would sweep the land. In your life, I hope that you will resolve to preach the gospel. We've heard tonight those who need it. There's people all around us. People close by. Have you told them the truth? Have you shared with them the words of this life? Do you know the words of this life? Have you been saved? Has your life been changed? Do you know Jesus as your Savior? Let's pray. Father, we come to you tonight. We're thankful for the opportunity to look into your word. Lord, we're thankful to see that you will triumph. Your cause will always win. Lord, and we're so thankful for that. We know the rest of the story. Lord, we know and we are certain your promises will not fail. Lord, as we serve you, first of all, you bless those efforts and those endeavors. Your word won't return void. Lord, you've given us a sign of your word. We know how things end. Lord, we know that you will prevail. We're thankful for that. Lord, we're thankful also for tonight for those who brought the gospel to us. Lord, let us be faithful in taking the gospel to others. Lord, let us persevere. Let us go again. Lord, let us not cease to declare and cease to preach and teach the words of this life. Father, open doors to us to do so. And Lord, should the circumstance arise, Lord, should that persecution grow, Lord, help us to obey you rather than men. Father, help us to have the strength and the courage and the love for you to rejoice even when the world counts us fools. Well, Lord, tonight I pray that you would bless this invitation. I don't know what words you might have spoken to a heart here, or maybe just a challenge. Preach the gospel. Lord, we need laborers. Father, I pray you bless this invitation according to thy will. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Just stand if you would with your heads bowed.